Hello, welcome to the course BH5BO6 Electrodynamics 2. The contents of today's lecture is taken from Fundamentals of Magnetism and Electricity by D.N. Vasudeva. We'll continue to discuss topics from Chapter 22, Alternating Current Circuits. In the last class, we have analyzed AC flow through an LR and CR circuits, where we have seen that in the case of LR circuit, the applied voltage leads the current by an amount phi, whereas in the case of CR circuit, the voltage lags behind the current by the same phase angle phi. Today, let's try to analyze AC flow through an LCR circuit where a resistor of ohmic resistance R, inductor of inductance L, and a capacitor of capacitance C are connected in series to an AC power supply. As in the previous class, we were trying to answer the question, for a given AC current I equal to I naught sine omega t to flow through the circuit, what should be the applied AC voltage? So as you can see in the diagram, there are three voltage components, one associated with the ohmic resistance VR, one with the inductor VL, and one with the capacitance VC. So let's first find out the values of these three voltage components. If I is the instantaneous value of the current flowing through the circuit, then VR is current I multiplied by resistance R. So in terms of the peak current, I can write this as I naught R sine omega t. Coming to VL, this is current multiplied by the inductive reactance XL. So this is I into L omega. I equal to I naught sine omega t. So VL equal to I naught L omega sine omega t. But we know that in the case of an inductor, the voltage leads the current by pi by 2. So to indicate this phase difference, I write it as sine omega t plus pi by 2. Sine omega t plus pi by 2 is cos omega t. So VL equal to I naught L omega cos omega t. Same way, VC, voltage associated with the capacitance, sorry for the typo here, this is current multiplied by capacitative reactance XC, which is I divided by C omega. Or in terms of the peak current, this is I naught divided by C omega sine omega t. Once again, in the case of capacitor, voltage lags the current by pi by 2, so the phase is omega t minus pi by 2. Sine omega t minus pi by 2 is minus cos omega t. So this is minus I naught by C omega cos omega t. Now the total applied voltage is nothing but sum of these three voltage components. So I can write E equal to VR plus VL plus VC. This is the EMF equation. Now substitute for VR, VL, VC, you get E equal to I naught R sine omega t plus I naught L omega cos omega t minus I naught by C omega cos omega t. From the second and third terms, I can take I naught cos omega t as a common factor. So I have E equal to I naught R sine omega t plus I naught into L omega minus 1 by C omega cos omega t. Where this term L omega minus C omega, this is L omega is the inductive reactance and 1 by C omega is the capacitative reactance. And there is a minus sign here because these two reactants are out of phase by 180 degrees. So essentially, this term represents the total reactance offered by the inductor and the capacitors together. So this is known as the total reactance XLC. Coming back to the EMF equation, as always, I can take out the common factor outside. So I'm going to take out the current as a common factor and also square root of R square plus L omega minus 1 by C omega whole square as a common factor. So the EMF equation now becomes I naught into square root of R square plus L omega minus 1 by C omega whole square multiplied by R divided by square root of R square plus L omega minus 1 by C omega whole square sine omega t plus L omega minus 1 by C omega divided by the square root term multiplied by cos omega t. You know the drill now, right? Call this term as cos phi, where phi is the phase factor, and this term as the sine phi. Since this term includes the resistance term, which determines the power dissipation, you can call this as the power factor. Now substitute for these two terms. The EMF equation now becomes E equal to I naught into square root of R square plus L omega minus 1 by C omega whole square cos phi sine omega t plus sine phi cos omega t. The term inside the bracket is nothing but sine omega t plus phi. Now, what does this term mean? So here R is a resistance of the ohmic resistor, and L omega minus 1 by C omega is the total reactance of the inductor and the capacitance combined together. So essentially, this term is the total resistance offered by the LCR network to the AC flow. So this is known as the impedance, which is nothing but the total resistance or the effective resistance. So I can write impedance Z equal to square root of R square plus L omega minus 1 by C omega whole square. Or in terms of the reactance, I can write Z as square root of R square plus XL minus XC whole square, which is nothing but square root of R square plus XLC whole square. Coming back to the EMF equation, look at this constant term now. This is nothing but the peak current multiplied by the total resistance, which is nothing but the peak voltage. So the EMF equation now becomes E equal to E naught sine omega t plus phi. Now, if you quickly compare this with the current equation, this looks exactly similar to the LR circuit. But let's try to understand the phase relation properly now. Now, what's the value of the phase? From the expressions for cos phi and sin phi, I can write tan phi as L omega minus 1 by C omega divided by R, or phi equal to tan inverse L omega minus 1 by C omega divided by R. Now, there are three possibilities here. One, L omega greater than 1 by C omega. Second, L omega less than 1 by C omega. Third, the value of these two are same. So, depending on these three conditions, the phase relation is also going to change. In the first case, when the inductive reactance greater than capacitive reactance, the value of phi is going to be positive. So in that case, you can say the applied voltage leads the current by an amount phi. Whereas in the second case, when L omega is less than 1 by C omega, this numerator is going to be negative. Consequently, phi is also going to be negative. So you have E equal to E naught sine omega t minus phi here, where the current leads the applied voltage by the amount phi. Whereas in the third case, when L omega equal to 1 by C omega, you can make out from this expression the numerator equal to 0, consequently phi equal to 0. So in that case, E equal to E naught sin omega t and I equal to I naught sin omega t. The applied voltage and the current both are in phase. So depending on the values of the inductive and capacitive reactance, you have three cases. In the first case, it looks similar to an LR circuit. In the second case, it looks similar to the CR circuit. Whereas in the third case, it's similar to an ohmic resistor circuit, an R circuit. Okay. So just for representing the waveform, I take the first case where phi is positive. So this is exactly similar to the LR circuit. So if you look at the starting point, you can easily make out that the voltage leads over the current by an amount phi. Coming to the vector diagram, once again, you can draw the vector diagram for any of these three cases. I just choose the first case where L omega is greater than 1 by C omega, XL is greater than XC. Consequently, the voltage component VL is also greater than VC. Now we have three voltage components, one associated with resistor VR, which is nothing but current multiplied resistance R, IR. One associated with the inductor VL, which is I into L omega, and the third one associated with the capacitance, which is I into 1 by C omega. As I said, since XL is greater than XC, VL is also greater than VC. So I have a large component in the upward direction and a small component in the downward direction. If you look at the diagram, you can easily make out that these two are out of phase by 180 degrees. So when I take a vector summation of these two, I get a smaller arrow in the upward direction whose magnitude is I into L omega minus 1 by C omega. So this is the VLC component. So here, if you look at these two components now, this is the in-phase component. This component is in phase with the current, whereas this component is the out-of-phase component. Now I can calculate the vector sum of these two components indicated by this arrow whose magnitude is I into square root of R square plus L omega minus 1 by C omega whole square. And in this case, compared to the current, this component leads by a phase angle phi. Similarly, you can draw the vector diagram for other two cases as well. Now, for the next couple of minutes, let's focus our entire attention on to the third condition, where the inductive reactance equal to the capacitative reactance. Now, what is the implication of this condition? If you look at the expression for total reactance, XLC equal to L omega minus 1 by C omega. So at this particular condition, when L omega equal to 1 by C omega, the reactance becomes 0. Similarly, if you look at the expression for impedance, at this particular condition, this entire term vanishes and the value of impedance becomes the value of the ohmic resistance. In other words, the value from this expression, you can see the value of impedance becomes lowest when L omega equal to 1 by C omega. In any circuit, when impedance is the lowest, the current becomes the highest. So this particular condition where the impedance of the LCR network becomes lowest and the current in the circuit becomes highest is known as the resonance condition. You would have heard resonance in the context of mechanical system, where you would have seen that in the case of an oscillatory system, at resonance, oscillation becomes the highest, or amplitude of the oscillation becomes the maximum. Now, what are the implications of the resonance condition? First one, as I said, the reactance of the circuit becomes zero, so the current in the circuit is maximum. And from the expression for impedance, we can see that this term vanishes and impedance becomes equal to the value of the resistance. So the circuit behaves as though the inductor and the capacitor are absent. Now the frequency at which L omega becomes equal to 1 by C omega is known as the resonance frequency of the LCR circuit. Now if you make a measurement of the resonance frequency, you will notice that this is equal to the natural frequency of the LCR circuit when R is negligible. Just like an oscillator system where at the resonant frequency the amplitude of the oscillation is maximum, here also at resonance the strength of the AC signal is the greatest when the frequency of the applied EMF equals the resonance frequency of the circuit. Finally, at resonance, XL equal to XC. So consequently, the potential drop across L, which is I into XL, will be equal to the potential drop across C, which is I into XC. So I can say at resonance, VL equal to VC. Now, what is the value of the resonant frequency? As I said, this is equal to the natural frequency of the LCR circuit when R is negligible. In the last chapter, we have seen the value of the natural frequency of an LCR circuit where R is negligible. This is given by omega naught equal to 1 by square root of LC. This is angular frequency, or the linear frequency is given by omega naught divided by 2 pi, which is equal to 1 by 2 pi square root of LC. So this is the resonance frequency of an LCR circuit. Once again, keep this in mind. We are considering an LCR circuit. So actually, if you look at the natural frequency equation for an LCR circuit, there is an R term here. This is 1 by square root of 1 by LC minus R square divided by 4 L square. That is the actual expression. But since R is negligible, you can completely disregard the resistance term. That's why we can simplify this as this expression. So whenever you do an experiment in your lab, you need to make sure that the value of the resistance you are using is very, very small. Otherwise, what happens is the resonance frequency you measure in your experiment and the resonance frequency you calculate using this expression, both will be different. So in physics, whenever you do any experiment, the experimental data should always agree with the theoretical values. Of course, there could be minor changes due to some of the errors associated with your experimental procedure, your experimental equipment, etc. But within the allowed error range, the experimental data should always agree with the theoretical value. There are two important parameters associated with resonance. One is known as the Q factor and second one is known as the bandwidth. The Q factor is defined as the ratio of voltage across the inductor or capacitor to the voltage across the resistor at resonance. As I said, at resonance, voltage across inductor and voltage across capacitor both are same. So Q is defined as either VL by VR or VC by VR. Now, what is the physical meaning of this? As we know, the total applied voltage equal to VR plus VL plus VC. But at resonance, as you can see from this vector diagram, VL equal to VC at resonance, and these two are out of phase by 180 degrees. So at resonance, these two components cancel each other, right? So at resonance, VL plus VC equal to zero. So I can write E equal to VR. So Q is nothing but the ratio of voltage across inductor to the total voltage, or voltage across capacitor divided by the total voltage. What is the expression for Q? So if you are taking VL by VR, VL is nothing but I into L omega divided by VR, which is I into R. Since we are dealing with AC signals, it may not be possible to measure the instantaneous value of current because it changes quickly. So instead, I can take the DC equivalent of the AC current, which is known as the RMS current. In terms of peak value, IRMS is defined as I naught divided by square root. I'm sure you are familiar with this expression. So I can write Q as IRMS into L omega divided by IRMS into R, which is L omega divided by R. Or if you're following the expression VC by VR, then Q equal to 1 by C omega divided by R. So you can calculate Q using any of these two equations, and if you follow both, you will find that the value you arrive at are exactly the same. What is the physical meaning or physical significance of this Q factor? First one, from the very definition, you can see that Q is inversely related to the ohmic resistance. And we know that in any circuit, resistance is the guy which is behind the power loss in the circuit. Moment there is an ohmic resistance, invariably there is a power loss due to joules heating. So Q is related to the inverse of power loss, or 1 by Q I can relate it to power loss or the energy loss. Since we are talking about sinusoidal function, one complete cycle is 2 pi. So 2 pi by Q is nothing but the fractional energy loss per cycle. This is the first physical significance of the quality factor. Secondly, Q factor is also related to another important parameter known as bandwidth, which determines the frequency response of an LCR circuit. As we have seen, the inductive reactance, capacitive reactance, both are functions of frequency, right? One is L omega, where omega is the angular frequency, other one is 1 by C omega. So both are functions of frequency. So if you vary the frequency, you will notice that the current in the circuit also varies as a function of the frequency. So if you plot a graph between current and frequency, you get a curve like this, where the maximum current I naught is achieved at the natural frequency of the LCR circuit, which is nothing but your resonant frequency. And on either side, you can see that the value of the current is decreasing. Now, to calculate bandwidth, what you do is go to the 70% of maximum current, which is 0.7 I naught. So here you can see that there are two frequency values on either side of F0. The higher side value, call it as F2, the lower side frequency call as F1, and bandwidth is nothing but F2 minus F1. So you can define bandwidth as the difference between two frequencies on either side of the resonant frequency F0, where the current drops to 70% of the maximum current. Alternatively, what you can do is plot the same graph between power and the frequency. So in the same way, you will see that at the resonant frequency, the power is maximum, and on either side, the power is decreasing. So here what you do is go to 50% of the maximum power. So here the peak power is at 6.6. So 50% of that is 3.3. So once again, you will find two frequencies corresponding to the 50% level. The difference of these two will give you the bandwidth. So the alternate definition of bandwidth is the difference between two frequencies on either side of the resonance frequencies, where the power drops to 50% of the maximum power. Now you may be wondering, in the case of the definition with respect to current, we chose the 70% level, whereas in the case of power, we chose the 50% level. What is the difference here? If you look at the expression for power, power is I square R. So if you choose this point where current drops to 70%, so I equal to 0.7 into I naught. So when you take I square, this is 0.7 into 0.7, which is 0.49. which you can approximate as 0.5, right? So 70% of the current corresponds to 50% of the power. That's why you define bandwidth either at 70% of the maximum current or 50% of the maximum power. Now, how does the bandwidth determine the resonance sharpness? Let's take two situations here. One in which the LCR circuit has a low resistance, which is 3.5 ohm, and in the second case, the LCR circuit has a higher resistance, which is 10 ohm. From the definition of Q, we know that Q is inversely related to the resistance. So in the case of lower resistance, you can see that Q is higher, and in the case of higher resistance, you can see that Q is lower. From this graph, it is very clear that when Q increases, sharpness of the resonance increases. Whereas in this case, when the value of Q decreases, the sharpness of the resonance also decreases. So low value of R corresponds to high value of Q, which also corresponds to a sharp resonance. Now, what about the bandwidth? When the resonance becomes sharper, you can see that the width of the peak decreases, so bandwidth also decreases. So when the value of resistance is low, the value of Q becomes high, the bandwidth becomes narrower, and the resonance gets sharper. So this is the connection between quality factor, bandwidth, and sharpness of the resonance. Now, why is the sharpness of the resonance very important? I can explain that in the context of one of the applications of the LCR circuit. If an AC signal consists of several frequencies, then you know that LCR circuit gives maximum response only at the resonant frequency. Right? That is the fundamental feature of resonance. Now, such a resonance circuit can be used in radios for tuning the station. So let's try to understand the application of LCR circuit in a radio set. So I'm going to illustrate this using an example problem. Suppose a radio contains an LCR circuit with inductance equal to 100 microhenry, ohmic resistance equal to 5 ohm, and capacitance equal to 0.002 microfarad. And an AC voltage of 0.1 volt RMS is applied. What is the output voltage? Now, first point, where do you calculate the output voltage? An LCR circuit has three ports, the resistance port, inductor port, and the capacitance port. You can measure the output across any of these three components. So let's choose either the inductor or the capacitor, because we know that at resonance, output across the inductor is same as output across the capacitor. What is the reference frequency? Reference frequency f naught equal to 1 by 2 pi square root of LC. We know all the values here. So substitute for L and C, you get the resonance frequency f naught as 1.12 megahertz. Now the RMS value of voltage is given. Let's calculate what is the RMS value of current. This is nothing but the total voltage VRMS divided by the total resistance, which is the impedance Z. But at resonance, value of Z equal to value of R. So IRMS equal to VRMS divided by R. Substitute for these two, you get IRMS equal to 0.02 ampere. We are going to measure output across the inductor. So VL equal to I multiplied by XL, which is I into L omega. I equal to 0.02 ampere. L is 100 microhenry, omega is 2 pi into this resonance frequency, so you get 14.06 volt. So if you make the same calculation for VC, you will get almost similar value. So just compare the values here. You are giving an input of 0.1 volt, but at the output you are getting a value of 14.06 volt, which is around 140 times. So in other words, your LCR circuit amplifies the input signal 140 times. So this is the fundamental principle behind the usage of an LCR circuit in a radio set. Suppose you want to listen to a particular radio station. For example, like you want to listen to Radio FM Thrissur, which is at 91.9 megahertz. So radio station always transmit all sorts of frequencies. Among all these frequencies, you want to catch one particular frequency, which is 91.1 megahertz. So inside the radio set, you have an LCR circuit, which is a variable LCR circuit, because typically the capacitance involved in an LCR circuit is a variable capacitor. So for tuning the radio station, you rotate a particular knob. So when you rotate the knob, value of the capacitance changes. So you change the value of the capacitance in such a way that the resonance frequency of the LCR circuit now is 91.1 megahertz. So at this point, what happens? Among all the frequencies transmitted by the radio station, your radio is going to pick up 91.1 megahertz. It's going to amplify this particular signal, and the amplified signal is fed to the loudspeaker. So even though you have all the frequencies available, only one frequency is amplified, and only that frequency will be heard through your loudspeaker. Suppose you want to change your radio station. You want to listen to Radio Mango, which is at 91.9 megahertz. What do you do? You turn the knob. So you are changing the value of the capacitor. You change the value in such a way that the resonance frequency of the LCR circuit now matches with the frequency of Radio Mango, which is 91.9 megahertz. Now what happened? Your LCR circuit picks this particular frequency, amplifies it. So now, compared to all other frequencies, the 91.9 megahertz frequency is the strongest. So that frequency will be played through your loudspeaker. So this is how LCR circuit is used to tune radio station. Now, once you understand the application, probably now you can appreciate the importance of having a sharp resonance. If you have a very, very sharp resonance, you can see that this particular point, the natural frequency or the resonant frequency, corresponds to a single frequency value here, right? So if you are using a sharp LCR circuit, only one frequency will be amplified at the resonance. On the other hand, if the resonance is not very sharp, then what happens? At the reference frequency, there will be many frequencies which is corresponding to this particular frequency. So multiple frequencies will be amplified, and at a time you will be listening to multiple stations. So it will not be, transmission will not be clear. So that's why if you want to have a clear audio, then the resonance should be very, very sharp, or bandwidth of the resonance should be very, very narrow. Usually when a signal, an electrical signal or any other signal, has multiple frequencies, one mathematical tool which is widely used to separate the frequency components is known as a Fourier transform. Probably you had heard this function in your mathematics course. Very interestingly, our human body can do Fourier transform. For example, ear is one system in our body which does Fourier transform. Suppose I play two sound of different frequencies together. Your ear can listen to both these sound waves and process them separately. You can hear these two sound as two separate sounds. That is fundamentally because your ear is able to do a default Fourier transform. On the other hand, such a functioning is not possible for your eye. Eye cannot do a Fourier transform. If I shine two different colors onto your eye simultaneously, for example, I am going to shine red and green color simultaneously at your eye. I cannot process these two colors separately. Instead, it is going to see a combination of these two colors. So red plus green, eye is going to process it as yellow color. Similarly, if I shine yellow and red colors simultaneously on your eye, once again, I cannot do a Fourier transform. It cannot process these two frequencies separately. Instead, it is going to process it as a combination of these two. So yellow plus red, you are going to see as an orange. So that's the fundamental difference between your ears and eyes. So that's about the analysis of AC flow through an LCR circuit, and also the characteristics of the resonance condition. So in the next class, we will learn how to analyze the phase relation between voltage and current in an AC network using J operator. Thank you.